So there's this thing called tip of the tongue phenomenon, which is exactly what you think it is, not really worth testing you on. It's that moment you have where you know you've got information in your long-term memory and that you would normally be able to get it out if you wanted it, but you just can't temporarily. Like, that's that question when people go, who wrote that song? You're like, oh, you hadn't asked, I could have told you. But if you hadn't been asked, you wouldn't even thought about it. So being asked about it, you're being put on the spot to go into your long-term memory and retrieve it. It seems like it's forgotten. But it might be a little while later, you're like, oh, now I know it, but the person's gone. Or the next day it hits you. Because it never wasn't there. It was in your long-term memory, but you couldn't access it at the time. You couldn't retrieve it at the time, and it came back later. Some memories you can't seem to get rid of. Flashbulb memories are what they're called. It's as if your mind took a mental snapshot of that moment or that situation or elements of that moment. And the flashbulb memory is in vivid detail and might last a lifetime. In my parents' generation, that memory was the day that John F. Kennedy was shot and assassinated. They knew where they were when they heard that. And your generation, mine included, 9/11, right? I know where I was when I heard that information. I have a very vivid, detailed memory of it. However, knowing what I know about memories, especially eyewitness testimony, I know a lot of it's reconstructed. So if I'm being totally honest with myself, I can tell you a few elements that are beyond question. I know they're true. But other elements aren't missing, but I don't really know. So I was in the psychology department at Virginia Tech, which is on the fourth floor of Daring Hall. When I was walking down the hallway, I looked, as by chance, into the main office where Susan Anderson's desk is in the front room, and Jack Finney, the chair of the department, is in the back. And I saw a bunch of people gathered in Jack Finney's room, staring that way. Now that's unusual, so late selection, it grabbed my attention, and I looked in and wondered why are all these people gathered in his room in the back. And so I wandered on in and saw that everybody was looking at a TV up in the corner on top of a file cabinet. I think it was on top of a file cabinet. It was up in the corner, and I had realized at that moment that I had been in that office many times and never noticed the television was in there. But now it was impossible not to see it. And I saw what everybody else saw that day, and I was shocked and horrified as that was everybody else. And I never forget that moment. Now, the details. I was probably wearing a white shirt because I wore one every day, but I don't know for a fact. I was probably wearing black pants because I wore them and still wear them virtually every day that I work. Probably the case. Tie of the day? No idea, but I don't see myself in my memory without a tie on, right? My memory supplies details that are plausible. I don't know who all was in that room, but I believe Jack Finney was. It was his office. I could actually see other people in the room in my memory, but I can't verify for a fact that with the people that I think were there. You see what I'm saying? So the details may not be exactly right, but there's that flashbulb moment that I remember and probably will continue to remember for the rest of my life. Now, a lot of people have flashbulb memories, and here are some common situations that they remember. How many people remember a car accident they've been in or witnessed? It's hard to forget that. Remember we talked about the amygdala? When people witness something that is potentially traumatic or deadly, that's a hard thing to forget. When you are a participant in that, it's even harder to forget. When you met your first college roommate, well, for most people that wasn't all that long ago in this group, the night of your high school graduation, some people forget for other reasons, right? The night of your senior prom, if you went or not. That's interesting. I didn't go. I didn't go to any proms. I didn't go to any dances after seventh grade. I was that guy. It's like, that's a bunch of mine going to that. Mm-mm. But then I started dating this girl when I was a senior, and she was a little younger than me. She wanted to go to the prom, and I was like, well, if you want to go, then I'll go. Right? Because I like you and you like that, therefore I'll do that. And I started making plans to go. But the week before we were supposed to go to the prom, she went into cocaine rehabilitation. Which is good for her, bad for me. That was the end of our dating. But by God, I remember it. I remember not going to my senior prom. And it's right there, right? I remember it. Early romantic experience, time you had to speak in front of the audience. What do all of these things share? Emotional content, sometimes of a dramatic nature. And in that sense, they tend to get frozen in our memories and they persist longer, though keep in mind that just because it seems like there are a lot of details there, those details are not necessarily accurate. Your mind doesn't have holes in it when you remember things without accuracy. It just fills them in with what seems to be very plausible and compelling details, which is why people give testimony under oath and say, yes, I know it was that way. I certainly remember it that way. And they're not lying. They believe that what they remember at that moment is a fully, wholly accurate representation of what happened at the time they're trying to recollect from.